Welcome to Take the Lead Radio with Dr. Diane Hamilton, where she interviews some of the most successful leaders, entrepreneurs, authors, speakers, and other individuals who will inspire you to take the lead in your career and personal life. And now, here is Dr. Diane Hamilton.
Welcome to Take the Lead Radio. This is Dr. Diane Hamilton, and I'm so glad you joined us today because we have Jennifer Moss here. Jennifer is an award-winning journalist, author, and international public speaker, and she has a new book, The Burnout Epidemic, and it's so timely. And I'm really looking forward to having her on the show, so stay tuned, and we'll be back right after this.
Are you interested in finding out more about how HR professionals or leadership consultants can become certified to give the groundbreaking new Curiosity Code Index assessment? The certification program will provide the ability to administer the assessment at reduced rates. Participants will learn how to interpret the results of the CCI, as well as how to deliver an innovation plan workshop designed to improve curiosity, engagement, innovation, and productivity. To find out more, go to curiositycode.com.
I am here with Jennifer Moss, who's an award-winning journalist, author, and international speaker. She's a nationally syndicated radio columnist. She's reporting on topics related to happiness, workplace well-being, and a lot of other things. You've seen her on Huffington Post, Forbes, SHRM, Fortune, Harvard Business Review, you name it. And her book is Unlocking Happiness at Work. And her latest book is The Burnout Epidemic, The Rise of Chronic Stress and How We Can Fix It. I'm so excited to have her here. So welcome, Jennifer.
Thanks for having me. I'm looking forward to our chat.
Well, this is, you know, going to be a lot of fun. I know your last book, as I mentioned, Unlocking Happiness at Work, got a lot of awards, Distinguished UK Business Book of the Year. I mean, just you've received so much recognition for being an innovator and Female Entrepreneur of the Year and all the awards you've received, and especially the Public Service Award from the Office of President Obama. Congratulations on so much success.
Thank you so much. I think, you know, you probably feel the same way, where you're so passionate about what you're talking about and you care deeply about the subject matter. It feels like all those other things are these sort of cherry on the icing of the cake that is your career. And so I feel, you know, very privileged and fortunate to have a job that I enjoy doing, unlike so many other people out there who don't.
I can imagine. And I think happiness was such a hot topic, and I could see why that's so important. I had Michelle Geelan on, you know, and she's married, of course, to the other happiness expert. And I go, what are your fights like? You know, you guys are so happy.
Yes. It's so true. Actually, Sean wrote the foreword for Unlocking Happiness at Work, and I know
that's nice.
Both of them quite well, and Amy. And they're just as genuine as you could imagine. You obviously know this, but
right.
Yeah, I don't even think they do fight.
Yeah, she was so nice. I really liked her. And I've seen Sean speak so many times. And I think that happiness is such a hot topic, but I think burnout is even hotter right now. And you are so timely with your books. This is really something I talk about a lot on the show, and I talk a lot with and on another show I do on, you know, communicating in the media and things, and how people are burned out from Zoom and whatever product they're using and to communicate. And there's so much stress because it just seems like everybody's 12 hours on conference calls, and then they got to work after that or something. You know, it's just crazy time. So I want to get into your book, and I want to get into all what made you want to go that direction. But I want to get your backstory and what made you a happiness and burnout expert.
Well, you know, I started out studying journalism, and then I went into that space for a while, and I worked actually in publicity for a bit, you know, in creative industry, and then started working for a professional services firm, a large one, Robert Half International, in their communications side. And so what I came to really understand is the value of data and how that translates into telling stories. But also in my work there was really focused on understanding the workforce and their impact. And it actually was a personal story of sort of post-traumatic growth. My husband was a pro athlete, became acutely paralyzed. He's fine now. I just put that in there. But it was a reset moment for us, in that you know, all of a sudden your identities changed. We were living in California. We realized we wanted to move back home. There was just a paradigm shift, kind of like what everyone's feeling right now. And when we moved back, we really started to understand why, you know, Jim had this recovery moment, and a big part of it, and why they said, you know, they said originally he wasn't going to walk again, and why he walked out of the hospital after 6 weeks, was a lot to do with psychological fitness and well-being. And I think that, you know, when I started to understand how much time we spend at work and how miserable lots of people are, I thought, let's spend some time really digging into the research there. But over time, what we started to also recognize is that there are about 20% of people that are really happy and flourishing at work, but there's 80% of people that aren't. And the way that we're solving for that is with really, you know, downstream tactics and perks and stuff for people that are already well, instead of tackling the root causes of stress that lead to people's unhappiness. And that's what's propelled me, is really just trying to help that 80% of people that aren't doing so well so that they can enjoy what the 20% of people actually benefit from.
Well, you know, that's such an important figure, and it comes up a lot in engagement talks and different things that, you know, people who've been on the show. And, you know, we know how much hundreds of billions are lost each year, you know, just the company perspective. But I love that you're coming at it from the employee perspective, you know, because I think that gets overlooked so much. And I think when I was looking at curiosity and perception, I was trying to figure out what's keeping people back. You know what I mean? If you could figure out what stops them, then you could help them move forward. And with my research, I was looking at, you know, if you could develop curiosity, you could get people doing things that they'd care about more, that they're interested in more. And I think with burnout, you know, people are burned out a lot of times because they're not even aligned properly. And do you think that that has something to do with it?
I totally agree. And I love your work on curiosity, because it's a tenet of human-centered leadership is, you know, using empathy, and empathy comes with curiosity. And the more we actively listen to each other, the more that we can recognize, you know, how to provide better policies, develop communication strategies, just manage better. If we're designing all of that in the image of other people and not just in the image of ourselves, and the only way you could do that is through listening and curiosity. And so I have seen that when you really look at the root causes of burnout, we often attribute it just to overwork alone. And yet there's six root causes, and they are systemic, and they're policy driven, and they're infrastructure based. And we have a role that we have to play as individuals, but unless everyone's sort of working at it from all sides, then we won't really be able to solve for burnout or chronic stress.
Yeah, I mean, you brought up an important part about empathy, and I wrote my doctoral dissertation on emotional intelligence and its impact on performance. So when I had Daniel Goleman on the show, it was like, yeah, this is so great, you know, because I could talk to him about all this. And he was saying, you know, that he thought curiosity was, you know, the key competency of the future. And so what you're doing is you're doing the same things that I think that some of the top experts are looking at. You know, it's this whole look at all the things that impacts us, because I know you say that self-care doesn't cure burnout. And I'm really interested in what does cure burnout, but let's talk about why self-care doesn't.
You know, like I said, that we approach to problem solving for burnout is really critical. So an element of us leading, you know, especially as leaders, modeling self-care is really important, because it provides permission for the rest of the organization to also behave that way. Mm-hmm. And we need to, as individuals, still have social emotional intelligence and psychological fitness so that we can just cope better with life and manage stress in our lives better. But when it comes to really solving for burnout, it is, like I said, that, you know, the causes can be attributed to lack of fairness, you know, so systemic discrimination. Right. We're looking at lack of agency, so being micromanaged, workload, obviously overwork. We're looking at lack of community, so lack of psychological safety at work. You know, all of those things, if we are, you know, we can do all the self-care in the world, and yet if those still structures exist in our workplace, then it's going to be very difficult to not burn out. So it has to be that, you know, it's still important, but it's more at that optimization level and less at that, you know, that early stage dealing with those big macro problems. And then they come together and that's when we actually solve for it.
Well, you bring up some things that Francesca Gino and Amy Edmondson both brought up, you know, different aspects of this on the show. Psychological safety, Amy talks about a lot. And, you know, of course, curiosity with Francesca. But, you know, what I think is really interesting is these wellness programs that companies have. And I've worked in a pharmaceutical company, and of course they would have wellness programs. And then I've worked in other ones where a lot of them send you email, you know, like this is what you should be doing kind of things. And I think we open them as much as we open any kind of spammy emails. You know what I mean? You see this and you go, yeah, I'm not opening this. I don't care how much I need it, or even if I'm good at my wellness stuff, I don't open that. Who opens it, and how do they help?
Yeah, I love that you said that, because I do think if we're in a state of readiness for something, then well-being isn't workload. But if we're working so much, if we have all these other impacts on our lives and we're dealing with macro stressors like a global pandemic all the time, these are just sort of, it feels a bit tone deaf from, you know, companies that aren't really looking at solving the problem in a real way. However, I mean, they're great if we're ready for them. And that's where the disconnect happens, the delta between leadership and what I think between employees is we don't ask enough. Just direct managers don't ask enough, like, how are you doing? And don't get into the gray area with curiosity and say, you know, you're saying you're fine. But, you know, I had this really great opportunity to talk to Dr. Martha Byrd, who is the chief anthropologist for ADP. And she says we should be, which I love that there's an actual C-level anthropologist. It's just phenomenal.
Right.
But she says, you know, I love that. But she said we need to be professional eavesdroppers, you know, in our leadership. And I really took to that concept. Like, we need to be looking, she says, at the semiotics, you know, what people are showing us in their nonverbal language. Are they tired? Are they withdrawing? You know, we should be listening to people saying that they're dealing with these things, you know, at home, and it could be off the cuff, but it's probably giving us a whole bunch of clues as to how people are feeling. And so that's where we need to get better at just asking. And then when we put stuff in front of people at that point, they trust that it's with best intentions. You know, they trust that we're delivering something to them that's based on their needs and not just this sort of, you know, a full broad approach to solving for something like lack of wellness in our organization.
Well, it's just such a time that everybody's giving so much workload to, you know, everybody's burned out right now. When I talk to them, they go from Zoom meeting to Zoom meeting to Zoom meeting. And then they got to do all their work after hours while they're teaching their kids, while they're, you know, I mean, I've never seen a time like this where everybody just, it's interesting to me how I go to places, either my doggy daycare or my restaurants or whatever I go, and they can't hire anybody because everybody doesn't want to work. They all want to start their own companies now so that they don't have to be doing this kind of thing. It's kind of, what do you think is going to happen based on all this?
Well, that's such a nuanced, you know, issue, I think, that's come out of the pandemic too. There's a lot of people that have left because they have faced their own mortality for the last 20 months and realized this is not actually what I want to do for my life. I want to go back to school, or I want to reorganize my time. You're also seeing just, you know, certain industries hit really hard. And so people had to find other new places to work. So women disproportionately impacted. We're at like really 1988 labor force participation for women. So there's just been these things that have been cataclysmic that have really changed just the demographics of the workforce. Mm-hmm. But I also see that people are tired. And a lot of those folks on the front line that had to spend 20 hours working in, you know, in the restaurants, in retail, in healthcare, in customer service, they've been depleted, not just with the fact that they're overworking, but also that they had to deal with being chronically undercompensated, undervalued. I mean, yes, we did have lots of parades at the beginning for folks, but that ended. And we had incentives with sort of danger pay at the beginning that was clawed back, which is really devaluating, devaluing people that are in those positions. And then they're also realizing that they had to make switches. So there's a whole bunch of ways that we need to get people back, but we also need to know how to upskill and reskill some of these people that could be chronically underemployed because there's just not the jobs there anymore. And so it's a whole bunch of different incentives that we need to think about and really thinking differently about what kind of environment these people are going to go back to. If it's just the same old thing and we're still in a pandemic where they're dealing with safety, you know, questions around their safety and health, they're not going to be able to attract people back to that, those industries.
It's really a time I've never seen anything like this, and where there's just so many places that they just can't find people to work there. And I think a lot of people want to figure out what's going on. It's just, I don't know that it gets acknowledged a lot that there's this burnout going on. I took a job as a dean, and the very first time I talked to one of my direct reports, he started off by saying, you know, he starts work at 5 a.m., he stops about 5 p.m., has dinner, comes back at 8 or 9, checks for a couple hours, and he never takes a day off. And I'm like, oh, wow, you know, this is terrible. Not what I want for you. You know what I mean?
No.
And and that was the culture of what was expected. And I thought, you know, this is not what I want for people. And I think a lot of leaders want to be able to measure burnout. I mean, I didn't need to know how to quantify that. All he had to do is tell me that guy's going to be burned out. So how can you measure burnout in your organization? Because I'd love to quantify everything as I do with my stuff. So how do you do it?
You know, that it's such a great question, because I'm a big believer in database decision making and why, you know, I do so much academic research and why I really appreciate you and the work that you do and folks like Amy Edmondson and, you know, those people that are really in the rigor, mm-hmm. to make sure that it isn't just a term that we throw around.
Right.
And you know what? Burnout has been sort of, I think it's been diminished because we've been talking about it like it's a whiny millennial problem, or, you know, it's just, you have this meme in your mind of a, you know, soccer mom trying to juggle all this cult of busy in her life. And I think when the WHO actually defined it as an occupational phenomenon, included it in its IDC 11, its International Classification of Diseases of Syndrome, it sort of elevated it. Everyone started to pay attention and focused in on Dr. Maslach and Dr. Michael Leiter. Research that they've been doing for, you know, decades.
Right.
And their inventory, the MBI, the Maslach Burnout Inventory, and also Dr. Leiter's Areas of Work Life Survey, they're really the gold standard for measuring burnout. And they've been able to, I mean, and I'm obviously going to simplify it, but they've been able to really sort of identify what are the, you know, what are the big signs of burnout and how do we sort of measure that within the organization in a way that's effective? And they've been able to, like I said, there's three real big categories, and obviously there's scales underneath these three big categories, but the one is just level of exhaustion. You know, how exhausted do we feel? And I think this year we are really tired, which makes sense. But a lot of that is that feeling at the end of the day, how tired do I feel? Am I still, you know, engaging in relationships that are meaningful? Do I still engage in my hobbies? Do I feel so tired that I don't really want to eat? I'm not, you know, resting. I'm feeling that dread in going to work. How frequently, and it's measured on a frequency scale sort of throughout every sort of week, you would sort of monitor that. And then also, do I wake up in the morning and feel like I can't get motivated? That's a big one. Like I can't get up and go. I'm just so tired. And then there's the engagement piece. Well, sort of what Maslach has identified as the antithesis of burnout is engagement. And when you're really highly engaged, and not necessarily the way that we measure it in the workplaces now, but it's more like we feel connected to our work. We feel valued in our work. There's a sense of accomplishment that we feel in what we do every day. And obviously the opposite of that, if we're feeling like we're not contributing anything and our jobs are meaningless, that's going to lead to burnout. And then the final one is cynicism. You know, how hopeless do we feel? How much control do we feel over the ways that we can change our circumstances? And that cynicism piece, when we did our research when I worked with Maslach and Leiter inside of the pandemic, we found that out of all of the the respondents and research and data that they've gathered, they've never seen a more cynical group, a more burned out group, but also a more cynical group. And that's what we're all worried about, is just the hopelessness that we can't change things. And that's when you really start to worry that people are going to fall off that cliff.
Well, you know, that's so interesting, because as you're saying all these things, it kind of reminds me of what I went through when I was trying to research curiosity, because there's, you know, big researchers in the area that measured the levels of your curiosity, like Kashtan. And there's great ways to find out if you have high or low levels, you know, and a lot of people use that to hire people. You know, you want more curious people or not. And I'm thinking, well, where are the assessments that tell you what stops it? And that, to me, as I'm listening, I'm thinking, you know, what's making you tired? What's making you feel dread? What's making you cynical? Is it social media? Is it, you know, what is it that's the thing behind the thing? And I think that's where people don't go deeper when they think about this stuff. They know they're tired. They know they're burned out. They know they're not engaged. They don't really love what they do. And I think that's where curiosity can come in. And I love that you have a leading with curiosity chapter, and you write about what leaders can do to develop a happier culture that's high on resilience and curiosity. I just wanted to see if you'd want to speak to that for a minute.
Yeah, you know, and I think you're right in these, what are the upstream problems that are leading to the downstream impacts of stress and burnout? And, you know, we're realizing that when we start to feel the exhaustion and the cynicism, a lot of it has just been these small things that are just happening consistently over time at work that go, you know, as Dr. Maslach describes them, they were pebbles and now they're sort of boulders,
chronic,
right? Like,
yeah,
those things that just grate at us every mm-hmm. day. And a lot of it is just increasing amounts of work that we didn't, you know, we weren't planning for, but because we are feeling a lack of agency, we can't say no, and they're just put onto our lap. Or we've dealt with polarization and, you know, discrimination systemically, then we get into the workforce and we don't see any other people that look like us or, you know, have the same values as us. And so all of those little tiny micro stressors are what end up getting people to a point where all of a sudden, okay, I'm feeling a little bit more tired. I'm feeling increasingly fatigued. Now I'm exhausted. You know, I was sort of hopeful and now I'm feeling cynical. That's sort of what all those pieces of those six root causes in lots of different ways, myriad ways, that ends up, you know, equaling this chronic stress. But from the curiosity standpoint, and why I say empathy is such an important tenet of leadership, is the curiosity piece kind of gets to the pebbles. Mm-hmm. It addresses those things. If we're thinking consistently and checking in consistently and asking beyond, you know, people saying I'm fine, knowing that they don't meet it, but authentically being curious about why they're saying I'm fine. If we can catch those things, those pebbles, before they turn into boulders, then we stop burnout. And so curiosity is one of the greatest prevention tools to actually making sure that we don't all burn out, because you then learn about each other. You care about what you're learning, and then you action that learning.
Right.
And managers need to get better about having these curious conversations every single week. They need to actually talk to their staff and ask them three questions. How are you? You know, how are you doing?
Yeah.
What are the highs and lows of this week? So give people an opportunity to go around and talk about the highs and lows. And then the next question should be, as a team, what can we do for each other to make next week a bit easier? I mean, very small goals, and it has to be something that's consistent and frequent so that you build trust. But those meetings that should take 25, 30 minutes and are regular, that's being curious and using empathy to then be able to reduce inefficiencies and workload and a whole bunch of other things that could be going on in someone's life.
You said so many great things, and something you said earlier made me think of, you know, people don't want to do because they'll get more on their plate. And one of the things we used to say at my job was, you know, no good deed goes unpunished. If you suggested an idea, you'd be the head of that committee and no more pay to do it. You know what I mean? So,
right.
You know,
yes.
I don't think leaders sometimes recognize that people back down and back away from that because they know they're never going to get rewarded. They're just going to get more and more. And the harder you work, the less you're rewarded sometimes. And as you brought up the curiosity aspect, I think the thing, you know, even boils down further is what's stopping the curiosity if we don't have it? And to get that curiosity, you got to look at that. And what I found was it was fear, assumptions, technology, and environment were the four things. And, you know, fear, of course, is going to keep you from ever wanting to question anything or to volunteer anything. And, you know, people are really held back by that. And that a lot of it times is stoked by your assumptions in your head of what you tell yourself based on the last guy gave me more work to do and didn't pay me, so I'm not going to say anything this time kind of thing. And, you know, and then the technology, we over and under utilize it. And in an environment, it could be a past boss or somebody else that you don't even know keeps you from, you know, what these people have had in their lives, their family, their friends. And I think it's really fascinating to look at what holds us back. And it's not just the employees that need to work on this. You say leaders can protect themselves as well. Is there anything different that they can do to protect themselves from burnout?
Well, you know, and I love what you're saying too about this, because I think it's so true that, you know, we talk about innovation, you know, quote unquote innovation all the time, and it's such a buzzword. And yet when you actually look at in cultures that innovate, they have a ton of, you know, room for trying and failing. They have celebrate like successes.
Fail forward,
they
yeah.
overread. Right. And mm-hmm. they over-resource so that if someone does come up with an idea that they have all of the infrastructure in place to sell, like to support the idea from actually being birthed instead of, oh, well, that's a great idea. Now you run with it. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's just so exhausting. And so right. then you end up not having innovative cultures. And so I think you're right. And all part of that is that burnout plays a role in our decisions, or protecting ourselves from burnout actually holds us back then from innovating in cultures like that. And when you talk about leaders and what their kind of what their role is, sometimes we have a hard time. I mean, I can speak for myself because I'm really passionate about my work, that I can sort of forget that I'm in the work, and flow is really important, but there's a difference between, you know, harmonious versus obsessive passion. And I've been in those times where it's become obsessive, where I'm definitely working too much. I'm not spending time on things that I should be. I don't have the right balance in my life, or integration, however way we want to describe it. And that's a problem. And leaders do that. They sort of take on the role of having to be stoic and protecting the team. They also take on, you know, their passion, and they care a lot about the stakeholder, and they have, you know, ambitions and drive, all of those things that are happening. And yet if leaders don't model the behavior, if they don't actually make a point to create that permission-based environment where people can disconnect, where they can log off, where they can have self-care, where they can, you know, have enough safety to say no and provide pushback, you know, to them. The only way they're going to do that is if they behave that way themselves. And if they don't, then there's just invisible pressure that they're like, here, you go on vacation, don't answer your email, but I'm going to go on vacation and answer my email, because I'm different. And that really has to be a major shift before we're going to really, you know, make sure that we can solve for it. And that means leaders then can practice self-care for the greater good. And sometimes that's what they need, is that push to do it for something bigger than themselves.
Yeah. And I think a lot of people don't recognize that their perception is different than their employees' perception of things. And I know I talked to Daniel Goleman about how he thought you need a 360 evaluation to really get a good grasp of emotional intelligence. And I know Francesca Gino's work showed that leaders often believe they encourage curiosity, but if you look at their employees, they didn't agree so much, you know? So I think sometimes getting an outside perspective can be really helpful. What do you think?
I completely agree with that. I can't even tell you how often, you know, you go in, and we used to do this analysis in my former role. When we were consulting, we go in and we do one of those sort of what the leaders are thinking and what the employees think, and look at the delta between the two. Right. And there was always quite a wide gap between, you know, how transformational leaders thought the company was and how open to change their employees were. And, you know, whether they were burning out is a big one. And most of them thought, no, we're treating our employees really well. And there's been really great data that's come out recently too, where you see a lot of employers say, no, I think we did a great job in the pandemic and my employees are really happy. And then employees are saying, actually, I'm miserable. There's 41% of the entire workforce looking at resigning because it was so bad. There's definitely a gap. And so you do need to get, you need to have leaders that are open to that gut check, that feedback. And it's not always easy for them to accept that their employees are not satisfied.
It isn't, you know, and I've interviewed Doug Conant a couple times, who turned Campbell Soup around, and he ended up writing 30,000 plus handwritten letters to everybody, you know, and took engagement from really low into it, really dramatically increased it. And I think a lot of leaders think, oh, am I going to have to do all these things? But it you know, sometimes it doesn't take 30,000 handwritten notes. You know, I mean, a lot of it is building that empathy. And, you know, I think we can learn a lot from those kinds of leaders who took that time to do those kinds of things and see what works for your personality and your preferences. But I love the idea of getting outside input, because you don't know what you don't know unless you ask, right?
So, that is so true. It's your day. You know, you get these answers and themes. You know, you ask people to share in their own words how they're doing, how they're feeling, and it's so rich, the understanding of what people are doing. And we found that too. I mean, there was a couple organizations really demonstrating good leadership. I mean, Hewlett Packard, for example, they had really high employee experience scores throughout the pandemic. And a lot of it was like, they just let their CEO go in these AMA style kind of communications with the team, with the entire org every single day, basically, at the onset of the pandemic, and just left it up for employees to ask them questions. Like, no question was too big or too small. They were not just, you know, it wasn't just monologue. It was dialogue between the organization and them. And these are simple ways of just making people feel heard or connected to them, and giving access to leadership for you to say, like, what is going on? I feel uncertain. And a lot of humility to say, I don't really know exactly what's going on, but I care, and I'm, you know, trying to do my best. And that is why I think they fared so well from the value that the employees felt during the pandemic, and why they haven't had as much attrition. That this was a simple thing for that CEO to do every single day until people felt assuaged. Like, we need to start doing more of that.
Yeah. And that really is what I looked at for the work we did. Dr. Maya Zelihich and I looked at perception. And sometimes, you know, you think about what you think is going on in your organization and what's really going on. There are two different things. And a lot of it is IQ, EQ, you know, as we've talked about with empathy and some of the other aspects, emotional intelligence, and also CQ for curiosity quotient, but CQ for cultural quotient, because what burns out one person in one culture that may not burn out another person in another culture. So how much is perception to play in all this?
Yeah, and you're like, that work is brilliant, because we do need to be able to understand that every person is dynamic, and that is hard to scale that. I mean, global leaders trying to figure that out it's not an easy task. It's a difficult thing, and that's why direct managers really being more consistently aware of what's going on helps a lot. But I think you're right. I think you need to just have this ability to recognize that, like, for example, you know, one company in the U.S., they're headquartered in the U.S., and they were starting to feel really good, and there was some hopefulness. This was, you know, just before the third wave. And then India, where a third of their workforce was based, ended up getting hit really hard. And so all of the communication that they were sending out, that you can't send out mass communication and not think about what every single group is dealing with and how they're experiencing, especially this pandemic.
Right.
And the more they were able to get really more, I think, agile in their communication and more empathetic, more curious about how people were feeling, the better it landed with people. And that means a lot of leaders have a hard time not getting sort of married or stuck to a certain way of thinking. And that's how it's worked in the past. So let's keep doing it this way. And yet if they, especially now, because we're in a paradigm shifting moment in history, that kind of leadership has to really go, you know, this worked before, this is going to work again, isn't going to be, often true right now,
right?
Because there's a whole different way of working.
That's the status quo is what, you know, when people ask me to define curiosity, really what I'm trying to do is get people out of status quo, because that's where you get the Kodaks, the blockbusters, you know, things that worked in the past don't always translate into the future.
Yes.
But, you know, as you were saying that as well, getting the message out, I could remember giving a talk as part of an event for Forbes. It was a CMO event, and their biggest complaint was really they're trying to get their marketing messages out at scale, but make people feel like it's personalized. And this is really the same kind of thing for your company. You want people to get the message in the way they want to hear it. And I need to talk to my daughter about this, because she works for a company called Split. They do kind of like this A/B testing, but very high end for ads. You know, you could change this word, change that word kind of thing. And I wonder if they could do something like that within companies on messages, so that everybody gets their message, you know, it goes out at scale, but it gets personalized based on their cultural need. But I don't know.
That's a brilliant idea.
Yeah. Hey, somebody listening, please create that.
Your daughter about that. Because it's so true. I mean, I think every leader in the world would love to figure out, you know, how to better communicate in a personalized way with every single one of their employees, because it's a really hard thing to do.
It is. It is. Well, if Split's listening, they should work on that aspect of their software, because I don't know if they're doing that or not. But I think there is a lot of opportunity for growth for a lot of people. And I think burnout is such a hot topic right now. You could see why your book is doing amazingly well, and Harvard Business Review Press, congratulations with all the work that you're doing. I mean, that's quite an accomplishment, and I think a lot of people are going to want to follow you, find out about your work, find out about your books. How can they find you?
Thanks so much. Yes, mm-hmm. It's been quite a ride writing a book about burnout in the middle of a global pandemic. I have to tell you there was lots of irony. There was lots of ironic moments where I thought, wow, I'm feeling like the expert and the user, you know, right now. I'm burning out while I'm writing this book, but it really has been, I think, a really enriching experience for my life. And so people can find, you know, more about me on my website, which is jennifer-moss.com. And then I'm on LinkedIn a lot. I like to have lots of deeper conversations there. I find that, you know, people will ask about the book, and I'm really good at having conversations there. So people can find me there. It's Jen, J-E-N, Lee, L-E-I-G-H, and Moss, M-O-S-S. So I'm there to have lots of conversations with folks after they have a listen to our conversation.
Yeah, I hope they reach out to you. This was so much fun, Jennifer. I knew I was going to enjoy this conversation. It's so timely. And thank you so much for being on the show.
Thank you so much. It was a pleasure. I really enjoyed our conversation.
Oh, it was. And we will be back right after this message. Curiosity is a critical and direct link to improving motivation and communication-based issues that challenge organizations. By improving workers' curiosity, you can enhance employee engagement, emotional intelligence, innovation, productivity, and many other byproducts that come with that intrinsic but underutilized attribute. To find out more about how to improve curiosity, please go to curiositycode.com. This show is going to be a little bit different today, and I'm kind of excited about it because I'm going to be talking about curiosity. And I talk on a lot of other people's shows about what I work on, but I want to talk to you about the value of building curiosity within your organization. So I guess I'm my guest today. So hi, I'm Dr. Diane Hamilton, and in addition to hosting this show, I am also the creator of the Curiosity Code Index, and I wrote the book, Cracking the Curiosity Code. And I give a lot of presentations where I talk about the importance of improving curiosity and getting out of status quo thinking. And it sometimes helps if I share a story that I think you might find fascinating. A lot of organizations are held back by a culture that doesn't really embrace curiosity. They just go along with the way things have always been. And so I like to talk about an experiment that I share on stage, about a hidden camera experiment where they looked at how quickly people go along with a group. This woman, she went into a doctor's office thinking she's getting an eye exam, but not known to her, everybody in the waiting room, they weren't patients, they were actors. And every so often, an experiment was going on where they would have a bell ring. And every time that bell would ring, all the actors around her, which she thought were patients, would stand up and sit down with no explanation. So after just three times hearing about that, from hearing the bell ring, I should say, and without knowing why she was doing it, the woman stood up and sat down conforming with the group. And so they thought, well, this is interesting. She's going along with what everybody else is doing. Let's see what happens if we take everybody out of the room. So once, you know, they called everybody back as if they were patients one at a time. And eventually she's alone in the room and the bell rings. And what's she do? Well, she stood up and sat down and she doesn't know why she's doing it. She's just going along with what everybody else had done, right? So they thought, well, this is fascinating. Let's just add some people to the room who are patients and see how she responds to the bell ringing and see how they respond. And so the bell goes off and she stands up and sits down and the gentleman next to her looks at her and says, why did you do that? She said, well, everybody else was doing it. I thought I was supposed to. And so the next time the bell rings, what do you think he does? Well, he gets up and sits down with her. And so slowly but surely, what became, you know, just was a random rule for one woman is now the social rule for everybody in the waiting room. And we call that behavior. It's an internalized behavior that we call social learning. So we see what other people do and we think, wow, that's kind of what I want to do because everybody else is doing it. And we kind of reward ourselves and because we don't want to be excluded. And it's just the part of how conformity can be comfortable, but going along with it just sometimes is you get bad habits, you stunt growth, you get the status quo thinking, and that could be the downfall of organizations. So when we do things just because they've always been done a certain way, we don't really progress and we don't look for other ways to find solutions. So I want to go beyond that. I want to know why we're doing things. Why is it important? And what are we trying to accomplish? So that's what I talk to companies about because I think they need to look at like how and where are they modeling and fostering curiosity and what action plans do they have in place to avoid status quo thinking and do they really have all the answers and how can they take what they learn from different events and utilize that to make some changes. And it's really important because curiosity has been, you know, the foundation behind the Model T to self-driving cars. And we know that leaders believe they encourage curiosity and exploration. But I've had Francesca Gino on the show, who's done a lot of real great research in this area. And we know that most of the employees don't feel rewarded for it if they explore their curiosity. So if we want organizations to generate innovative ideas, we have to help them through leaders developing that desire to explore, right? So my job is to be curious. I ask questions and get information for a living. And I do that through the show and teaching and speaking, everything I do. But I think it's something I want to share with other people because it's just such a huge part of what makes companies successful. I look at curiosity as the spark that ignites the process that everybody's trying to achieve. Think of it as baking a cake, okay? If your goal is to bake a cake, you've got all these ingredients. You have eggs and milk and flour, whatever it is it takes to bake the cake, and you mix it together and you put it in the pan and you put it in the oven. What happens? Well, if you didn't turn on the oven, you get goo, right? Nothing happens. And so that's a huge problem that organizations are trying to get. Instead of cake, they're trying to get productivity, right? We're trying to make money. They know the ingredients. They know they want motivation and drive and engagement, creativity, communication, all the soft skills, all that stuff. So they're mixing those ingredients. And what they're not doing is turning on the oven. And the oven, the spark, is curiosity. So if you don't turn on the oven, no one gets cake. So that's what I'm trying to talk to companies about. And, you know, we know that kids are naturally curious. I love a picture from the San Francisco Museum of Art from Life magazine in 1963. They have these two little girls. They're just adorable looking through this like grate on the ground, on the wall that they can see like behind the air conditioning vent kind of thing. And they're supposed to be looking at all the artwork on the walls, of course, because it's the San Francisco Museum of Art. But what do kids do? They want to see what's behind the vent, right? And we were all that way. Three-year-olds ask their parents about 100 questions a day. But at that age, you're just curious. You want to find out how everything works, right? And there's some time that we just eventually lose some of that. And think about it. When did you stop wanting to look behind the vent? And did somebody actually like say, stop that, get up, you're getting dirty, don't look behind there. I mean, we get that. That's what our parents do. You know, you have to behave. But we've seen a big decline in curiosity and creativity. There's some great TED Talks about the creativity aspect, which ties in very similarly to what curiosity, what we see. And it peaks around age 5, and then it tanks as soon as you, you know, go through school, about the age of 18 through 31 even. We're seeing very low levels. Sir Ken Robinson has a great talk about how we educate people out of our creativity and out of our competencies. George Land also has a great talk about his work with NASA. He looked at kids, he followed them at age 5, found that 98% of children were creative geniuses. And then by the time they were 31, only 2% were. And it was a huge difference. And a lot of it, yeah, well, George Land says, you know, that we have convergent and divergent thinking. And he talks about it in terms of, you know, we put on the gas and try to come up with all these great ideas, but at the same time, we over-criticize them and we put on the brake. So anybody who drives a car knows you put the brake on at the same time you put on the gas, you don't go very far. And that's kind of what's happening to our curiosity and our creativity. And I thought, well, this is really interesting because I think curiosity can translate into serious business results, and CEOs get that. But a lot of them are not investing in the culture of curiosity, but some of them are really doing some amazing things. So I want to talk about why, you know, what the cost is of lost curiosity. And what it is, you know, there's so many aspects of what costs companies. We know that they're losing $16.8 billion due to emotional intelligence if you ask the consortium for EI. Or if you look at Gallup's numbers, they're losing $500 billion a year lost due to poor engagement. I've seen everything from communication. Holmes has it at $37 billion. I've seen much higher. Just depends where you look. But we're talking tens to hundreds of billions for each of these issues: emotional intelligence, communication, engagement. It's a huge problem out there. And companies know that they're losing money, but they don't recognize the value sometimes of curiosity. And when we talk about curiosity, there's a big innovation factor, because we want to be more innovative, but we're worried about job loss. We're worried about jobs being automated. But we know that if we're not innovative, the majority of the Fortune 500 companies from 1995 are gone, and no one wants to be Kodak. Nobody wants to be Blockbuster. We know that, you know, Netflix just ate Blockbuster's lunch. And a lot of it, the reason those companies are not here is because they looked at things from the status quo way that they've always done things. They didn't want to cannibalize their product or whatever, you know, that they had the success they had. And if you do that, the world keeps moving and you get stuck, and then that's a huge problem. So it was interesting to me to study curiosity. There's a lot of research on curiosity, but there's not the great statistics I'd like to see. There's a State of Curiosity report that Merck did in 2018, and it showed that curiosity was higher in larger companies than smaller ones. It was, I think, 37% versus 20%. And then millennials were more curious than Gen Z and boomers. And the U.S. had a higher level of curiosity compared to China, but maybe they weren't as high as Germany. But it's, you know, that's just one report. I'd like to see a lot more research done. I think that it's fun to look at what experts have shared regarding the value of curiosity. And I mentioned that Francesca Gino did a great job with a HBR article she wrote, and I loved having her on the show. I hope you check out that show, because it's amazing. Because in that report, she talked about leaders recognize curiosity is important and they think that they're encouraging it. But we found that most of the employees don't believe that. Only 24% feel like they're curious about their jobs, and 70% said they face barriers to staying curious and asking questions. And so she did some really great research. If you get a chance, I would recommend listening to that show and also checking out that HBR article. I've had Daniel Goleman on the show. He was incredible. We talked about how emotional intelligence ties in. And he was cute because he said he can see why I developed a measure of curiosity, because I'm very curious. He was talking about an article in HBR as well by Claudio Fernanda, or I think it's A-R-A-O-Z, saying that curiosity is one of the most important competencies in the future. So that's a huge, plug for Curiosity coming from Daniel Goleman. And he was talking about younger generations have questioned organizational missions more than older generations. And we got into a great discussion about that. So I hope you take some time to listen to that show. Another great episode on the show was with Amy Edmondson, who has an incredible TED Talk. And she gets into curiosity and how it ties into collaboration. She does a TED Talk about teams and teaming, and she gets into how the Chilean miner disaster was able to be resolved because of a lot of it was because of curiosity. She says, you know, you got to look at what are you trying to get done, your goal, what's in your way, you know, your concerns, your worries, your barriers, stuff like that. And what resources, talent, skills, and experience do you bring? And then she talks about how they did all that to get those Chilean miners out from under that rock. So definitely worth watching her TED Talk. All of them have TED Talks that are amazing. A really great guest as well on the show was Doug Conant, who is the guy who turned around Campbell's Soup. And he did that by asking questions. He asked employees what motivated them. And then he looked at how to build engagement by writing, he says, 10 to 20 personal notes 6 days a week. He counted at 30,000 plus, which is huge. Because when he took over, I think it was in 2002, they had like 12% engagement. And by 2009, they were up to 68%. So he did some amazing things by asking questions, writing comments, giving input. All that stuff comes out of curiosity. And another great guest of the show was Xander Lurie, who's the CEO of SurveyMonkey, and they're so much into curiosity, they got permission to change their street address to One Curiosity Way. I love that. But I was asking him some of the things that they do because they have a culture of curiosity there, and they ask, you know, how can we make our products more productive for our customers? How can we create an environment where people do their best work? He says they do skip-level meetings so that they can find out what works and what doesn't. So those are just some examples of people who are on the show. And I think that there's other examples that I think are really fascinating. Some companies, Monopoly, Ben & Jerry's, Van Moof, Bicycles, some of those, I've looked at some of them to see how they used curiosity to just go a step further. Monopoly did some research because, you know, they always come out with the dog's version or cat's version, and they didn't want to come out with just another version. So they decided to come out with some research to find out what people did with Monopoly and what they can learn about it. They found out that a lot of people cheat, and over half the people cheat when they play Monopoly. So they came out with the Cheaters Edition. And that was their second biggest release since the initial release of Monopoly. So it was really a cool thing. Ben & Jerry's has got some really interesting information. What they do in terms of not getting into status quo thinking, they don't just keep flavors around forever. They do research to find out what's working. They ask questions. What's a good flavor? What's no longer a good flavor? And instead of freaking out that their flavors are no longer successful, they celebrate them and give them a burial. And I love that. They even have a headstone and whatever on their website, and where they show this flavor was, you know, alive from this year to this year, and they celebrate their success and then they move on. A story I think is really interesting is Van Moof. They make these bikes, and they would send them in packages in the mail or through UPS or whatever they would send. And a lot of them were ending up broken, and they kept trying to fix these bikes, this issue with the packaging. And they didn't want to spend a lot more money because if, you know, you make the package twice the size, you get a lot more expenses. And they're trying to figure out how to do this to make their bikes not break and yet not go over on the spending. And what they looked at was the type of box they were using. They noticed it was very similar to a flat screen television box. And they looked into how many flat screens broke, and they really weren't breaking. And the only real difference was the flat screens had a picture of a flat screen on the box. So they thought, well, huh, let's draw a picture of a flat screen, a little bit of extra ink, and see what happens. And it was a dramatic difference in the amount of damaged bicycles. So, you know, just thinking outside the box. Sometimes it's just asking questions. And Disney did a lot of that. They did some great questioning to find out what was happening with their turnover. The laundry division of Disney, as glamorous as it sounds, is not. And they were losing a lot of people that didn't really love working there, and they couldn't figure out why. So they just put out a questionnaire to their employees and said, you know, how can we make your job better? And really didn't expect to get things back that they could do anything about. But they did. They actually got back great things. And they got back things like put an air vent over my workspace or make my table adjustable so for, you know, when I'm folding things, it works for my height. And those are things like, yeah, we can fix that. And they did. So going to the horse's mouth, the employee, and say, hey, how can we make this better, was huge for them. Sometimes it's not just the employees. Sometimes it's leaders. I in the book, Cracking the Curiosity Code, I gave a story about Great Ormond Street Hospital in London. They were having a lot of patients that were dying when they were being transferred from one unit to the other. And some physicians were watching a Formula One race car event one night and were really impressed by how quickly that pit crew, the Formula One crew, would take the car apart, put it back together in 7 seconds. And they're looking at this going, wow, look at, they did that with no problems and we can't transfer people from here to here. So they thought, well, why don't we have these guys come in, this Ferrari team, and they can show us, you know, any kind of improvements that we could make. And they really did get some great ideas, which reduced their errors by more than 50%. So, you know, we think inside of our cubicle, we think inside of our silos, but sometimes we need to think outside of even our industry, because that can be really important. And some of the greatest ideas are from that. I've gave you some examples, but you know, we know we came up with Velcro from a Swiss engineer hunting with his dog. It came back with burrs in his fur. And he's like, well, what are these things? And why are they sticking? And what he did was he stuck it, you know, under the light to look at it. And he saw it kind of had a hook and eye, you know, the way it hooked together. And he thought, huh, why don't we try this? And they made, I think in 1998, they made something like $93 million in Velcro, and it was sold in 40 countries. I mean, it just did amazingly well. But you have to build a culture of learning. And to do that, I think it's really important to look at some companies that do a great job of it. And I know a top company I work with that does that is Novartis. Novartis does a great job because they have curiosity is part of their core cultural value. They actually encourage employees to spend 100 hours a year on employer-paid education to broaden their interests. And they do everything from paying for them to watch videos to having them perform in mini TED events, having employees be the actual speakers, things like that. It's really cool how much they do this. They actually have the whole month of September as their curiosity month. I'm one of the speakers for them. So I know how much time and effort they put into this. And it's just, if you look at how much everybody talks about how they liked working at the company, 90% of the employees surveyed approved of the CEO. Think of how often you see that. So that's a huge thing. And I know they're doing some ongoing research with Curiosity with Me. And I'm very excited for that. They have one of their employees is writing her doctoral dissertation. And we're looking at, you know, the curiosity, how it compares to if you intervene and give them some information about things that are holding them back. And so I'm really anxious to share that information when it comes out, because I did a lot of a lot of research for a lot of my talks and for my book, Cracking the Curiosity Code. And I looked at so much that's out there. I mean, we know that there's some great TED Talks from Daniel Pink. He wrote Drive, what a great book. Simon Sinek's Finding Your Why and all the stuff that he's talking about. Carol Dweck's book, Mindset. All those are huge. And I really think, you know, I started to look at what this is, this curiosity thing. Because it's actually, the Max Planck Institute coined the term the curiosity gene. Because it's in people, it's in animals. And, you know, it creates dopamine. It makes us feel good. And if you don't have curiosity, if you're a bird and you're just flying around a bush and you run out of berries, you're going to die if you don't have curiosity to go look at another bush. So I wanted to know, as I was researching for the book, I wanted to write about curiosity, but I'm like, okay, well, where's the assessment that tells you what stops it? And then I'm like, wait a minute, there isn't one. And that surprised me, because the assessments all told you if you were curious or not. And that's all well and good, because you do want to know if somebody's highly curious or not. And, you know, big five factors will tell you if you're open to experience and things like that. But I want to know what stops it. And so nobody had studied that. So I did. I wanted to know what holds us back. And I found out what it is fate. And fate stands for fear, assumptions, technology, and environment. So I want to talk about these separately, because fear is about failure, a fear of embarrassment, loss of control. Nobody wants to feel like they said something stupid in a meeting, right? We all want to feel like we're all prepared. So we're all in the meeting and we're thinking, I want to ask that, but I don't want to look dumb. So you lean next to Joe next to you, go, hey, Joe, why don't you ask? Because it's better for Joe to look dumb, right? You don't want to look dumb. And that's a huge problem in companies, because you get a lot of yes men, yes women, because nobody wants to shake up things or look like they are trying to, you know, confront their leaders. And leaders who haven't modeled the value of curiosity will come across that way. And, you know, I've had leaders look at me and say things that, you know, I had one guy, he asked me to do something and I said, sure, I'd be happy to do that. I've never had to. How do I do that? And he looked at me with disgust and said, I'm going to pretend I didn't hear that. So what does that make you feel? Well, first of all, it tells you you're an idiot, I guess. It tells you that you should know this. You should lie and pretend you know things. I don't know. You know, we get a lot of leaders who will say, don't come to me with problems unless you have solutions. And that sounded really good at the beginning, because it sounded like we were going to get rid of these whiners and complainers that didn't really have any ideas. But a lot of people don't know how to solve the problem. But if we say that, then we're saying we don't want to know about problems. So that's a huge, huge issue. And then the assumptions that we make, that's that voice in our head that tells us we're not going to be interested, I'm apathetic, it's unnecessary. Last time I did that, they gave me more work. Whatever it is, we all have that voice, you know, it talks us out of stuff. I sometimes I'll hold up a bottle of water in a talk that I'm giving and I'll ask how much water is in this. Or actually I say, how heavy is this, I should say. And they'll say 6 ounces or 8 ounces or whatever. And I'll say, well, it doesn't matter. What matters is how long I hold it. Because if I hold it for a minute, it doesn't bother me. My arm's fine. You know, I hold it for an hour, I start to get tired. My arm gets tired. And after a day, my arm feels paralyzed. And that's kind of how our assumptions are. The voice in our head, if it's a fleeting thought, no big deal. We get past it. After an hour, we might hold on to it a little more. After a day, you know, it starts to stay with us. And so we have to recognize that we might be telling ourselves all of these things of things we could maybe be interested in, or maybe somebody would help us learn, but we talk ourselves out of them. So assumptions are a big thing. What I found interesting was technology was also a big factor. And curiosity is impacted by over and under utilization of technology. So it could either do it for you, or you're not trained in it, or you're overwhelmed by it. Some people have had great experiences in their childhood where they had a lot of foundational learning in technology. Steve Wozniak's one of his book, I loved his book, I Was, he talks about his dad telling him how to connect gadgets. He would come back with all these wires and get things from work and show him how the electronics should be connected and why this wire was necessary and how it brought electricity. But a lot of us don't have that experience. And a lot of us might be the greatest mathematicians in the world, but if somebody just threw us a calculator and or Siri did it for you, you're not ever going to really have the foundation behind it. So there's got to be times where we have high foundation days where we build without technology and we just learn behind it. And then there's got to be days where we take advantage of it and learn how can we use it and not become overwhelmed by it. And then environment's a big one for a lot of people, because it's everybody from your teachers and your family, your friends, your social media leaders, peers, your past leaders, your current leaders, everybody you've ever worked with, basically. And, you know, we know that curiosity can be influenced by everybody we're around. I mean, the numbers I gave earlier about how it peaks about age 5 of curiosity and then it tanks after that. A lot of that could be, you know, going into school, the teachers don't have time because they're teaching to the test. You got so many students in class, you can't answer why all the time. And, you know, our siblings can be brutal. I mean, if you do something that they don't think is cool, then you could take the wrath from that. And it's very challenging to look at what has impacted us. And I think that's one of the reasons why my research was so interesting to me, because I looked at these four factors of fear, assumptions, technology, and environment, fate, and those were the, you know, inhibitors for the curiosity code index, and they were pretty evenly matched. Assumptions were higher and environment were higher than technology maybe, but then you can have an overlap. Fear, you know, you could have fear of technology, for example, And so it was really fascinating to do the research. I studied thousands of people for years to see what inhibited them. And I started out by just putting a thread in LinkedIn and asking people. And then I thought, got really interested in that. And then I hired people to do, you know, all this factor analysis, and I ended up doing my own research, because a lot of the research kept coming back in the same fashion of just trying to find out if you're curious or not. And I didn't want to do that. I wanted to find out what inhibits us. And it was kind of interesting to look at the difference between men and women. Men were less impacted by fear than women, but they were more impacted by that voice in their heads. They were kind of equal to women in technology, but then maybe more impacted by their environment. So, I mean, these are not, you know, these results are what I've seen, and I'd like to see more research done. But it is interesting to take a look at how these different factors impact us. And so what I do is I train people to, first of all, they take the Curiosity Code Index, and I either go do the training at companies myself, or I train consultants to give it, or I train HR professionals to give it. If those people get certified, they get 5 hours of SHRM recertification credit. So there's a lot of different versions of training that I offer. But what's really interesting is when they go through the training class, the employees are, when they're training about this, they get to find out their results from the CCI, and then they get to learn. It's just like taking a Myers-Briggs or a DISC or something. It takes 10 minutes. You get the big report back, the PDF, within a few minutes of taking it. And it's just real simple. And they get to get their results. And then they kind of go through this kind of personal SWOT analysis, which is kind of cool, because they look at ways to create SMART goals, measurable goals, those kinds of things, to overcome some of these areas that are inhibiting them. And so not only do they do that, but then we do kind of a similar thing for the corporation as a whole, kind of back to like how they did at Disney. You go to the horse's mouth, you go to the employees and say, how can we fix these things within the company? But how can we help you become more curious? So if there's issues with innovation, engagement, whatever the company issues are, the training classes are a great starting place to go to the employees and say, how can we make you more curious so we can have this end product? How can we get cake, right? And you find out. And the trainers go back to leaders with this great report. This is what employees would like to do to help them improve so that we can all improve and make more money. So it's really important to, you know, the future of companies that, you know, the people have to try it, explore it, poke at it, question it. And it's just a huge thing that you need to ask yourself about, you know, how can I be vulnerable and allow this culture of learning? And maybe I don't have all the answers. And think about, what are you doing to foster curiosity, and what action plans do you have? How do you do this in this really tumultuous time? And thinking about this, it's very challenging for a lot of people. I have created a kind of a free course. A lot of people can get a lot of value out of, if you're interested in taking it. If you go to drdianehamilton.com and scroll down to the bottom, it just offers a free course. If you sign up, it's a simple thing. They just send it right to you, and you can learn a lot more about curiosity and the factors, and see a lot of videos from some of the talks I've given, and some of the stuff I'm talking about here is in there. But a lot of the chapters from the book are in there, and it's just a really good foundational way to learn more about curiosity. So I just wanted to give you that information, and I hope you check out drdianehamilton.com and curiositycode.com.